His praises shall continually be in my mouth. No matter what I see or how I feel, as long as I'm breathing, oh yes I'm breathing, I'll bless the Lord. As long as I'm breathing, oh yes I'm breathing, I'll bless the Lord. Father, have your way in this place. You be glorified in it all. Come on, let's raise it together. Say,
I will bless the Lord at all times,
and His praises,
and His praises
shall continually be
in my mouth.
No matter what I see,
no matter what I see or how I feel,
as long as I'm breathing,
as long as I'm breathing,
oh yes, I'm breathing, I'll bless the Lord. As long as I'm breathing,
as long as I'm breathing,
oh yes, I'm Alvin. Come on, say, oh magnify.
Oh magnify the Lord with me.
Let us enjoy
Him. Let us enjoy Him.
That's the reason why we're here tonight. Let's lay down our cries.
Let's lay down our crowns
and lift up
His name.
We're coming to do it together. Let's do it together.
Let's do it together.
Let's go. Help in this room. Hey, let's do it together.
Let's do it together.
That means you. Hey,
let's do it together.
Let's do it together. Y'all ready to praise Him right here? Listen, cause you've been better than good to me.
Better than good to me.
You've been better than good to me.
Better than good to me.
I wish I had witness tonight. You've been better than good to me.
Better than good.
You've been better than good to me. Come on, real big. Cause you've been better than good.
You've been better than good to me.
When I thought it was over, you've been better than good to me.
Cause
you've been better than good to me.
Oh,
you've been better than good to me. Guess what? I should have been
dead.
Guess what? But you've been better than good to me. Should've lost my mind.
Should've lost my mind.
You've been better than good to me. I should've been dead.
Something has to break. Something has to break. You've been praying for a long time. You've been waiting for a long time.
Waiting for a long time.
It's breaking, 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 it's breaking.
God bless you. This is, as I say repetitiously, Super Sunday. You always have that moody Monday when it should be a marvelous Monday, terrific Tuesday, a wonderful Wednesday, a triumphant Thursday, a fun Friday, a sensational Saturday, but here it is, Super Sunday. Thank you for tuning in and listening to us streaming live. We are still worshiping the Lord in spirit and in truth virtually. Though we are not in the sanctuary, it ought to be your prayer, it is mine. Lord, make me a sanctuary. We are having a motivational Mondays, and this Monday, tomorrow, we are going to have the Browns to come. Thank you, Bakers. Thank you, Whitfield. Certainly my prayers go out to the Whitfield family and to the Baker family. But this Monday, we are going to have the Browns to come and encourage us. And so I pray and ask that you would tune in and listen to them on this Monday tomorrow. We plan on tentatively to come back into the Wings of Love Church New Year's. It's going to be a surprise. It's doing a little renovation, here in the sanctuary. And I will ask all of the members, once you see it, to contribute, because it is good that we will beautify our sanctuary. We want to see some changes. You want to know where your money is going, and we want to show you where your money is going. And so we thank God for Minister Alvin Jackson, our tech man, and he's doing an awesome job, amen, keeping us streaming live. And so thank God for him, that he brought some men in, experts and professionals, who know how to set up the sound system in our church. Because I don't want to be hoarse when I'm preaching, and especially those who are singing. And so I hope that you would have great anticipation to get back in here attentively New Year's. Also continue to pray for our governor. I am thankful to God that they caught these men and arrested them. They had planned to kidnap the governor from her vacation home. But let me tell you, that no weapon formed against us shall prosper. And I continually to pray that God will be a fence and a defense around our governor. Get out and vote. Get your souls to the polls. What a privilege that we have, and a freedom to get out and exercise our vote. Send in an absentee ballot. Whatever you have to do to get out and vote. And I say this again to my young people. You're saying, Pastor, my vote don't count. Yes, it do. It do count. People shed it, blood, sweat, and tears, that we might have this privilege and freedom and opportunity to get out and vote. Got next month, 1 month coming up. Come on, I need you to get out and vote. We're asking that you would give. Thank you so much. I don't have enough tongues to express my gratitude during this pandemic, especially to the members of Wings of Love. I love you with the love of God, and I pray that your giving will not be in vain. God gonna make up the shortest. God's gonna provide, because we're not trusting the government. We thank you for the stimulus check, and they trying to plan on giving another one. But it do not matter whether it's on hold or not. God is able to supply our needs. So three ways that you can give, and I really appreciate your giving. Well, there's a word from the Lord that I want to share with you, what God has given to me. And I just want to talk about this morning, by the aid and assistance of the Holy Spirit, a radical church in a, watch this, reckless and rootless culture. It's time for the Church of God and Christ to get up. And I'm not talking about denomination. We got to start speaking up. We have to stand out, and we are going to have to say something. That's what I like about John Lewis, when he said, when you see trouble, say something. And let me tell you, my brothers and sisters, we can make a change, because we are the agents of change. We are the moral compass. You have other groups, Black Lives Matter. You have other people who are involved and participating and protesting against injustice. And we need to get out of the shaker, which is the local assembly. We are the salt of the earth. And we are the light of the world. And so I want to talk about this, that it would provoke our thinking, and it would stir us to get up and get out and start witnessing and sharing the good news of Christ. Because let me tell you, change and transformation is not going to come in our communities, our cities, and in this country, brothers and sisters, with bombs and burning buildings, rocks and sticks and bottles. If there's going to be a change and transformation in our communities, in our cities, and in our country, we must take the good news, the gospel of Jesus Christ, to every man, woman, boy, and girl. We can't sit back and play it safe. We got to stand up and be counted. As John Lewis said, it's some good trouble. So I want to share this with you. Listen now. A radical church in a reckless and rootless culture. Let's go in and hear a word from the Lord.
I need thee, oh, I need thee. Every hour I need thee, oh, bless me now, my Savior, my Savior, I come to, Lord, I come to thee, I need the every hour, Lord, I need thee. Oh, bless me now, my Savior, I come, I come to, I come, Lord, I come. Lord, I come to thee. There's a word from the Lord. I'd like to invite your attention to the New Testament collection of writings. The book of Acts. The book of Acts, the 17th chapter and verse 6. The 17th chapter of said book, the book of Acts. And verse 6, these words are recorded in your hearing. And when they found them not, they drew Jason and certain brethren unto the rulers of the city, crying, these that have turned the world upside down are come hither also. Want to place our sermonic spotlight on that portion of this passage where it states, these that have turned the world upside down. I'm going to tag the text and talk about a radical church in a reckless and rootless culture. Listen this morning, my brothers and sisters, no one can refute or reject the fact that we are living in a reckless, meaning heedless, without caution, careless, and wild culture. Not only are we living in a reckless culture, but also a rootless culture. Rootless suggests cruel, without pity, without compassion. And let me add, a racist culture. Racist suggests the belief that certain races, especially one's own, are inherently superior to others. I want you to know that there is no superior race, and any race that think they are superior to another race is ignorant to the fact, because God is the only superior one. If we look around us, we see hatred, we see strife, we see division. We see that poverty this morning is rampant. Class conflicts is on the rise. Sexism also is on the rise. Disease is widespread. Broken families are the rule and not the exception. Crime, vice, violence, drugs, and drinking have become the norm in many communities. Sexuality, homosexuality, immorality is on constant display. Without a doubt, it seems that all hell has broken out in our midst. And the tragedy is that the church of Jesus Christ has become silent and quiet. Oh, brothers and sisters, I want you to know that I do commend and congratulate other groups like Black Lives Matter that are on the street protesting against systemic racism and injustice. But let me tell you, brothers and sisters, it is time for the church to speak out, to stand up and stand out, not just other groups and institutions. It's time for the church to stand up and speak out and stand out. Many people who call themselves followers of Christ are standing by all the time, just watching things happen and doing nothing about it. Somebody said there are people who watch things happen, and there are people who make things happen, and then there are people who don't know what's happening. But let me add, there are some people who do not care what is happening. There are people this morning who live their whole life, and the world doesn't even know they're alive. They exist. There are Christians who have absolutely no effect on anybody or anything. You just want to sit back and play it safe. And you're saying, well, let me say to you, Pastor, the enemy is not attacking me. Well, let me tell you, well, perhaps the enemy has not attacked you as the church, because you are no threat to him. But if you are a threat to him and what he's doing in the lives of those who he inhabit and control, he will come against you. Some people never, brothers and sisters, amount to anything. They just go along to get along. And I come to tell you that the church cannot just go along to get along. Many believe that if you want to make it, you conform, and the Bible tells us not to conform to this world, but to be transformed by the renewing of your mind. They say you adjust, you fit in, you find a way to, watch this, be accepted, not to rock the boat. However, in order to bring change and transformation within the lives and the minds and hearts of men and women, boys and girls, we must introduce them to Jesus Christ. Brothers and sisters, And we must do it, watch this, not unflinchingly, unapologetically, but do it rather courageously. We got to do it, brothers and sisters. Watch this. Not fearing. You got to do it, let me tell you, rather unflinchingly, unapologetically. We have to do it without compromise. Not with guns, not with bottles, not with sticks, not with rocks, not by burning buildings down, but we can do it by sharing the good news. For Jesus said, If I be lifted up from the earth, not buildings, not a bishop, will draw all men unto me. Essentially, then, this morning, when Jesus is lifted, large crowds of people will be attracted to him. Why? Because Jesus has magnetism. In this horrible hour of heartache and headache, in this period of pain, in these moments of mayhem and mishap, this morning, today, right now, we need a radical church. Radical mean going to the root, to the source, to the origin, affecting the fundamental, the basis, the deep-seated, the underlying of something. We need a radical church. And we know, brothers and sisters, what's behind the wickedness and the evil that exists in our culture, in our society. Satan is behind it all. One that is willing, that's the kind of church we need. One that is willing, brothers and sisters, to speak out against injustice, corruption, ungodliness, sin, and unrighteousness. I'm not talking about bricks and mortar. I'm talking about you, because you need to understand that we are the church. Jesus said, upon this rock, I'll build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. We need to come against the gates of hell. Oh, brothers and sisters, the Bible said that the kingdom take it by force. Evil is seeking to defeat good. Darkness this morning is seeking to put out light. Hate is seeking to overcome love, which it will never do. We need to understand that spiritual problems have to be fought with spiritual power. Only the Holy Spirit can give us the power. We need to ward off the evil and deceptive practices of Satan. Also, we must become knowledgeable of the Holy Bible, the Word of God, and internalize it so that we will be empowered to deal with evil that is seeking to overcome us. I don't care what the political scientists, social strategists, criminologists, psychologists, or economic theorist says about addressing the ills in our culture, in our society. You need to understand, it's not until the church gets involved, brothers and sisters, the reckless and the rootless will continue to act out in our communities. They will continue to act out in our cities and in our country. Yes, only a radical church, not a scared church, not a weak church, not an impotent church. We need in 2020, in this day and time, we need a radical church that declares to a deteriorating, decaying, and dying world that the resurrected, reigning, and soon returning Son of God can rescue people from this reckless and rootless culture. Matthew 18 and 11 says, this is Jesus talking, the Son of Man is come to save that which was lost. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. For God sent not his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. St. John 3:16-17. It's time to stop playing church and start being the church of Jesus Christ that is relevant and real to the times. We've been having a lot of services and church programs where folks have been shouting, dancing, speaking in tongues, but nothing around them has changed. We are supposed to be the agents of change upon the earth, the moral compass, because some people will never read the Bible. They're looking at our lives. Jesus said that ye are the salt of the earth. In other words, we are the ones that should bring flavor to an age of distaste. We are to penetrate. We are to preserve, because we're living in a rotten society. Ye are the salt of the earth. And not only are ye the salt of the earth, Jesus said, ye are the light of the world. Let me tell you, that light represents revelation and illumination. We must not only talk the talk, we must walk the walk to be able to take on the world this morning. Without the world taking over the church, is to become what Longfellow said. Listen, in this world, a man must either be an anvil or a hammer, meaning that he is either a molder of society or is molded by society. And let me tell you, being a radical church, don't let the world mold you. Don't let the world tell you how to dress, what to eat. Don't let the world tell you what to say and how to think or to change the figure this morning. Most people, and Christians in particular, watch this, thermometers that record or register the temperature of majority opinion, not thermostats that transform and regulate the temperature of society. It's time out for the church being thermometers. We are to be thermostats. A radical church is a powerful church. It's powerful enough this morning to influence the climate of the culture of the world. We ought to be in the business of turning the world upside down, meaning to disturb, to upset, to stir, to make it better. I'm not saying, brothers and sisters, that we are, listen now, to try to build a better world for, watch this, us as Christians to live in, because we know that this world is not our home. We need to understand that we are citizens of two worlds. We're citizens of this world and we're citizens of the kingdom of God, but we ought to make a difference down here on this planet. Turn it, listen now, the world upside down, mean to disturb, to upset. We ought to upset, we ought to disturb to the point where people feel uncomfortable in their sins, where people are ready to turn from darkness and come into the marvelous light of God. We ought to disturb, we ought to stir them to the point where they're ready to leave a dying life to a life where they can live abundantly in Jesus Christ. Oh, my brothers and sisters, Paul and Silas were radical men. These two men were influencing and changing the world they lived in. Christianity meant something back then. Christians were doing something, not blending in, not trying to fit in, not going along to get along, but molding and shaping the world around them for Christ. Although they viewed Paul and the others who preached the gospel of the kingdom of God as these that have turned the world upside down, what they were really doing was pulling the world right side up. They thought that these men were coming to disturb, to destroy, to cause disorder. But the only thing Paul and Silas was coming to do was to introduce them to Jesus Christ, who could deliver them from the power of sin, from the penalty of sin, and soon from the presence of sin. They didn't come to cause confusion, but to try to get men to convert to this newfound religion called Christianity. As the narrative opens in the book of Acts, chapter 17, Paul and Silas and Luke have left Philippi after a rough experience. Paul and Silas, having been beaten with rods, you can read it in the earlier chapter, and bruised and bloodied and been thrown in a dark, dark, dirty dungeon. They had gone through all kinds of pain in the stocks that stretched their limbs and cramped their muscles. Through it all, Jesus Christ had been glorified. Souls had been saved, decisions had been made, lines had been drawn, and a new church was born in that town called Philippi. So they had rejoiced, and now they have left Philippi, and here they are in Thessalonica. My brothers and sisters, they had passed through, and look at them now. They had traveled a long distance.
They had passed through Amphipolis and Apollonia. And these men were not ready to take a holiday or just to lay low in spite of what they've been through. They were still ready to share the gospel of Jesus Christ. The ideal of bagging down and slowing down and taking it easy never entered Paul's mind. Paul and Silas were people who made things happen. Every time they took a step, the world shook. They affected the people around them. What they did every day of their lives mattered. Paul and Silas made waves in the world. They were men that disturbed, according to the authorities, men that stirred, men that upset. And yes, they did. They did disturb. They did upset the political and religious system of that day. They were accused of disturbing the community and threatening the peace and infringing upon the people's rights. But let me tell you, brothers and sisters, when Paul preached, there were, watch this, many that were moved to give their lives over to Jesus Christ. Let me say that again. When they preached, there were many that were moved to give their lives over to Jesus Christ. The record says here in the 17th chapter that men who were devout, the Greeks, who were God-fearing, these men gave their lives to Jesus. But not only did the men, but there were women of prominence. There were women of influence, leading women who gave their lives to Jesus. Perhaps they were school teachers, lawyers, judges, congresswomen. Perhaps they were males or business women, because in Thessalonica, they were allowed opportunity. And these women contributed to the public sector. And listen, my brothers and sisters, the men were jealous and they were envious because of the following and the loyalty of these God-fearing Greeks and these leading women. They were jealous and envious because of the attention and recognition that Paul was receiving. And you know, my brothers and sisters, that's how it is today. I'm not going to be long. People are envious and jealous of you because of your success. Even being a pastor, there are some preachers who are envious of one another because of the size of the pastor's church, or what he drive, or how he dress. And let me tell you, my brothers and sisters, you can't help that. People are going to be envious of you because of your success, your achievements, and your accomplishments. And so these men were envious and jealous of Paul. But not only do I see them being envious and jealous, I see them now forming a mob. Secondly, notice the mob gathering. They went out into the streets. They got those who were of the baser life. They went out and grabbed the lowlifes, the thugs, and they began to arouse the people. They caused a commotion. And let me tell you, a lot of folk like to follow the crowd, but let me tell you, the crowd is not always correct. The crowd can be wrong. These men were ill-informed. These men, brothers and sisters, no doubt wanted to push their own agenda. And let me tell you, my brothers and sisters, they had went into the house of Jason because Jason was hiding Paul and Silas. This kind of sound like Breonna Taylor, don't it? When they went in with a no-knock warrant and these men got off. And it seemed like right here in the text, these men had rushed into the house of Jason, who was a convert. And the record says they dragged him out and brought him and those who were with him before the magistrate, before the authorities. And they tried to find something to accuse them of. They made up something and said that these men were guilty, listen now, of sedition, meaning they rebelled against the government. They accused them of treason, acting to overthrow one's government. They were saying that they were trying to overthrow the government or to harm or kill, if you will, the sovereign or king. They formed the mob. The mob gathered, brothers and sisters, though the mob was ill informed. They were going around saying that here is one walking around talking about Paul and Silas, saying that Caesar was nothing, but here is another king by the name of Jesus Christ. You see, my brothers and sisters, they were loyal and they were dedicated to Caesar, but they did not understand that these men did not come to set up an earthly kingdom, because the kingdom, the government of Christ is spiritual and eternal. But the throne of Caesar was, watch this, physical and temporal. Let me tell you, my brothers and sisters, when they accused these men of treason, it sounded like the men, the militias, who had plotted and planned to go and kidnap our governor from her vacation home, who made them jury, judge, and prosecutor. I am glad that these men were captured and arrested. And so, brothers and sisters, they dragged Jason out of that house because they were trying to find Paul and Silas. But let me tell you that Paul, brothers and sisters, brought a message. It was just not any message. It was the message of the gospel. And let me tell you, my brothers and sisters, it is a message of love for the unlovely. It is a message, yes, of mercy for the miserable. It is a message of grace for the guilty. It is a message of forgiveness for the fugitive or the one that has fallen. It is a message of salvation to the sinner. And so, first of all, I told you about the many that were moved, yes, to give their lives over to Jesus Christ. Secondly, the mob gathering. But now, the message of the gospel. And I tell you that only the gospel of Jesus Christ is destined to overturn bigotry, superstition, ignorance, atheism, vice, cruelty, and racism. Yes, that's what the radical church need is the gospel of Jesus Christ. And you know that we need to disturb, to overturn, to flip over, to unsettle. But the only way we can do it is with the gospel of Jesus Christ. And it will overturn all existing thoughts and habits, methods, and institutions that is not of God. Do you hear me? I want you to know this morning, yeah, that it will and overturn any and anybody that is coming against God and His Son. Yes, I want you to know, as a radical church, the gospel reaches out to those who are sick of sinning, troubled with temptation, broken in spirit, and suffering in silence. Do you hear me? Yeah. I want you to know, my brothers and sisters, yes, if we're going to affect a reckless and rootless and racist culture, we must learn as the church that we got to be radical. Do y'all hear what I'm saying? And I come to tell you, my brothers and my sisters, we need to lift up Jesus Christ. And that's why the hymnologist said, how to reach the masses, those of every birth. For an answer, Jesus gave the king. And if I be lifted up, I draw all men unto me. Lift him up. That's what we gotta do, radical church. Lift him up. Lift him up. Lift up the precious Savior. Oh, lift up the precious Savior. Still. He speaks from eternity. And if I be lifted up from the earth, will draw all men unto me. Oh, the world is hungry for the living bread. Lift up, I said, lift up, lift up. Oh, lift him up. Lift up the Savior for them to see. Trust him and do not doubt the words that he said. I'll draw all men unto me. Good morning, church. But keep lifting him up. Lift him up. Still, he speaks from eternity. And if I be lifted up, I'll draw all men unto me. Lift him up. He was born of a virgin. Lift him up. He raised the dead. Oh, lift him up. He healed the sick. Oh, 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 oh. lift him up. He fed the hungry, lift him up. He died on the cross, dropped him low, stretched him wide, yeah, and hung him high. But he died. Oh, y'all don't hear what I'm saying. It was early Sunday morning. He got up with all power in my hands. Do y'all hear what I'm saying? How you feel about it, but I made up my mind. I'ma be a radical church. I'll go and tell it on the mountain. I'll go and tell it everywhere I go. He is sweet, I know. I'll tell him that he's been a father for me. I'll tell him he's been a bridge over troubled water. I'll tell him that he water in dry places. I'll tell them that he is a rock in a weary land. Can't nobody do me like Jesus. God bless you. May heaven smile upon you. Let me tell you, we need a radical church in this reckless and rootless culture. The only way we can be radical in this world is that we got to go out and be salt. We have to be light in the world. We can't leave it up to other groups and other institutions to do it. The Lord has left us down here. We are his hands. We are his feet. We are his mouthpiece. So if there's going to be change, there's going to be a radical change, a radical transformation, it's going to be up to the church. Every head bowed, every eye closed. Dear God, our Father, I thank you. Thank you for this word. Help us to be like Paul and Silas. What people will say to the church, they're turning the world upside down. We want to disturb them and stir them to the point where they come running asking, what must I do to be saved? Oh God, that they would come from the kingdom of darkness into the kingdom of light. Leave the kingdom of Satan and enter into the kingdom of our Christ. We pray that thou would change them. Lead them to godly repentance. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. And thank God.
Turning the world upside down. The authorities and the religionists, they blame Paul and Silas. They accuse them. And when you say turn the world upside down, that's what they stated. In other words, they were saying that you have caused disturbance, disorder, confusion. But they didn't understand that Paul and Silas did not come to disturb or cause disorder. order, they came to share with the town, to the city, to let them know of a deliverer, Jesus Christ, the Messiah, the anointed one. They didn't come to cause confusion. They come to let the city know that you can be changed if you believe and accept the gospel of Jesus Christ. And let me tell you, my brothers and sisters, we ought to be modern day Pauls and Silases. We've got to turn this world upside down. We have to upset some things. Matter of fact, we have to cause one to want to come out of darkness into the marvelous light, from sin to salvation, from death to life. Yes, we are coming out. I believe the church is before Jesus get back. And they're going to accuse us of turning the world upside down. Matter of fact, you turn it upside down so you can turn it right side up. I hope you got something out of that message. I hope that it really, watch this, cause you to want to get up and share your testimony with others, starting with your family and your friends. Oh, God bless you. Continue to pray for Christendom as a whole, that we'll get out and be radical in the midst of a, watch this, reckless and rootless culture. There are three ways that you can give, and I really appreciate it. Thank you so much for your gifts. Thank you for sacrificing. And I know God is going to meet your needs. I know God is going to make a way when there seems to be no way. And so I want you, brothers and sisters, that when you give, pray over it, that God will give you a miracle of multiplication. Don't forget, Motivational Monday. God bless you.